Yes, let us make our lives an alleluia. That was beautifully played, beautifully sung. It is such a blessing to be here in this church again with you and with Reverend Sally. I thank you for inviting me. It's a wonderful opportunity to share and to feel the love that I've already received from so many people saying welcome. Just a warm place. I thank you. I'd also like to thank my husband, who is my life partner and the wind beneath my wings. He really is my support. And of course, I thank God for waking me up this morning and allowing me to speak, even though I didn't sleep well through the night with my cold and whatever. But I know that He's here in our presence, and my voice is working, so I am very blessed and happy. Before I get started, I want to say that Jim and I, and it was said before, but we live back and forth between the Bronx, New York, and Cape Cod. We are members of St. Albans Congregational Church in Queens, which is an all-black church. Here on the Cape, our home church is West Parish of Barnstable. Both churches have influenced our lives in amazing ways. And now, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. Today's scripture, one of them is Matthew 22:37-40. Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the laws and the prophets hang on these two commandments." We are going to turn things around and look at the second commandment first today. Love your neighbor as yourself. But what happens when you don't love yourself? When I was a child, I didn't always love myself. My mother, father, grandparents, aunts, and uncles were all very good to me, and I knew that I was loved. But I was a child of the 60s, born 3 days before Rosa Parks refused to sit to give up her seat in Montgomery, and the same month and year as Dr. King's oldest daughter, Yolanda. So when I looked in the mirror, I saw an image that looked very much like the children in Birmingham, where young people marched in the children's crusade for the right to be treated with dignity. Yet, they were met with angry police and the teeth of vicious attack dogs, and with a tsunami-type force, were hosed down in the streets. When I looked in the mirror, I saw an image that looked very much like the three little girls who were killed, excuse me, the four little girls who were killed in church, a sacred place, while worshiping just because they were black. I, too, was in church that Sunday, September 15, 1963, in New York, attending my second grade Sunday school class. When I looked in the mirror, I saw an image that looked very much like Ruby Bridges, who was 6 years old, just a year older than me. She had to be escorted to school by U.S. federal marshals and was still cursed at and spit upon by parents who hated the very sight of her. When I watched TV, I didn't see many people who looked like me. The adults and children were white, regular people, people with all the privilege that the United States Constitution granted them. When I saw black people on TV, they were on the news doing something wrong or something very bad was happening to them. When I saw black actors, they had parts that made me feel embarrassed and ashamed. On TV, they said beautiful people had blonde hair and blue eyes. That was definitely not the image that I saw in the mirror, or the image of many of my friends and family. Even the image of Jesus looked nothing like me or my people. How do I love my neighbors as myself when I'm not sure if I love myself? I looked to people who did look like me to see how they survived. I looked to my mother, who this day, right now, is on her knees praying for me. I looked to my father, who was an assistant superintendent of the Sunday school. I looked to my grandmother, who taught Sunday school for about 50 years. This grandmother was taught and loved by teachers from Massachusetts who journeyed down to the Low Country in South Carolina. I looked to my church family. They were all looking to the Lord and calling on the name of Jesus. Jesus. Sometimes I was like, why do they have to say it quite like that? Jesus, thank you, Jesus. I was like, okay, you know. Now I understand completely. Where was I? well, I'll tell you how I did it. How do you love the God with all your soul and with all your soul when it aches with the hurt of racism? When your young, tender soul has been spiritually damaged? How do you love God with all your mind when your mind can't wrap itself around the idea that perhaps you belong to a people who come from a lesser God, a segregated God? Well, I'll tell you how you do it. You look to the Lord anyway. Yes, I'm talking about racial discrimination, but we all have problems. I thoroughly understand that people of color are not the only ones who struggle from day to day. We all have issues. We all have stories to tell. Stories that hurt our hearts, bruise our souls, and confuse our minds. We all need to look to the Lord anyway and love Him unconditionally as He loves us. My family alone could weave together story threads of racial discrimination that could create a quilt that could blanket this church. My parents, grandparents, and church family looked to the Lord and called on the name of Jesus. Their descendants, even when others might think, what do these people have to be so thankful for? When I think back on slavery, and I think of the faithfulness of African Americans when they could see no hope for the future, yet they still continued to be faithful, it astounds me. These descendants of African ancestry answered the question posed in Psalm 137:4. How can we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? Music has truly been a respite, a saving grace for African American people. It was used during slavery to uplift in the most treacherous times, when many whites called the slaves who were dancing and singing a bunch of happy Negroes or the N-word. They were trying to hold on to their sanity through insane circumstances. Music has been part of the survival of black people, and it is part of the worship. There's a term known as call and response that began in Africa. A leader calls out something and the group responds. You can hear that in jazz, where the instruments converse with each other. You can certainly hear it in gospel music. In the words, you hear that there is an establishment of a very personal relationship with God. He's not a distant, far away, in the clouds God, but a friend who is absolutely accessible. See, black people weren't going to therapy sessions with an expensive, well-educated psychologist. Church has always been the most powerful form of therapy for many individuals. It is through the praise of God that generations of African American people have persevered, survived, and even thrived. I want to bring a bit of the black church here today. I want you to listen to this song. You will hear the leader speaking, in fact, requesting a response from the congregation. Okay, Ross, this is where I need you. Hit it. That would be, praise is what I do. And I want you just to listen. I know that Glenn is awesome. I heard his enchanting music, but I wanted to bring a bit of the black church. Look at the words. Okay, go ahead, you can play. I'm sorry. You'll hear the leader. This is William Murphy's song. Praise is what I do.
That's the Glenn church. Let's declare a church. You hear someone speaking to you. Maybe we can just listen a moment. Sat there and I said, "Dear God, give me a sign that you are with me."
And when I went into the church, people were talking and whatever, and the pianist came up, and I said, and he doesn't, I haven't heard that song in a long time. That is the first song he played on the piano. You know, but while people are sitting in the church getting together, I said, ask God for a sign, and then tears came out of my eyes, because I had been singing it all morning, and that's the first piece he played. And I said, I know that God is speaking, and he is here. This powerful and emotional connection through song fills our spirits with the type of euphoria that heals the soul. It has restorative powers. Look to the Lord with praise in your heart and faithfulness in your spirit. Through songs of praise, black people struggled from slavery to presidency, and there are still many issues to resolve. When I grew up, I became a teacher. I worked in a school with beautiful children from all over the world. Many of them spoke different languages and had many different looks. But we were one community. We were neighbors, love thy neighbor. We shared time and space with each other. We were different, but in so many ways, we were the same. And I loved them all. Okay, not all the time. I had to pray for that some mornings. Pray, help me with this child. But anyway, but I did love them. And just in fact, recently, I've been retired for 5 years, and one of my students from Virginia drove up. Her parents came, and she's now about 15, 16, anyway, because I had elementary school. And she they came all the way from Virginia to New York to have dinner with us, because she still wanted to be with me, and I was so blessed by God. A Japanese family, and it was just so beautiful. But yes, we were one community. Like all of us here, we belong to the most important race, the human race. We all come from families. We all need to eat, sleep, wear clothes, and have a safe place to live. And of course, we all need to be loved. So there are many things and ways where we are the same. There was a problem in New York City between a Korean grocer and a black customer. Things got very bad. There was a fight in a store, which led to a bigger fight in the community. New York City's first black mayor, David Dinkins, tried to calm the city. He told teachers to promote peace and harmony in their classrooms. I looked to the Lord and thought about the Sermon on the Mount where Jesus said, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God." I wanted to be a peacemaker. That's when I created my first important work of art, my multicultural children, the Scribble Kids. You will see them downstairs in a cartoon. Characters, and I made a poetry poster and a Pepsi ad honoring Dr. Martin Luther King. That ad was in Ebony Essence, Black Enterprise, many of the African American magazines, and then it made Sports Illustrated for Kids, the back cover, and I was delighted and humbled by it. So I'm going to do that poem for you because it's one of my favorites, and it's the first time I use my Scribble Kids to be little ambassadors of peace. In the picture, you see a group of children from all over the world, and they're saying this. It is a message that they need to give to the President of the United States. It is a message that they need to give to people today. When you see this picture, please open up your mind. Don't pick out certain children. Don't choose your favorite kind. Just look at us and see. We're standing strong and tall. Look inside our hearts. There's beauty in us all. We come from different places, from different backgrounds too. But here we are together with one strong point of view. We're here to make things better. We're here to make you see. We can't exist on things like hate. We all need harmony. We may not know our history and how things got this way. We only know tomorrow's gone if we don't change today. We say we share a common flag of red and white and blue. Why can't our multicolors then stand for something too? So look at us and marvel at what the world could be if we strived for peace on earth and racial harmony. Thank you. Amen. West Parish is our Cape Cod church, and it's very special. When my husband and I first moved to Cape Cod, I looked for a church. This church is 3 minutes away from our home by car, and it's a congregational UCC church like our I was back home in Queens. So I decided one day, I decided to attend West Parish. I became that little girl from the 60s who watched Ruby Bridges entering an all-white school, and I felt a nervousness rush over me as I assumed it was an all-white church. As I approached the door, would I be accepted, I thought, or looked at with thoughts of, why are you here? Then God sent one of his angels to greet me at the door. Her name is Celia. Celia's about 90, 91 now. But anyway, this was in 2008. Celia welcomed me with her beautiful, warm smile. She extended her hand and linked her arm in mine and said, you come and sit with me. She ushered me into the church. I still get chills when I think about it. God's presence was felt, and my fears were immediately allayed. By the way, I've asked her, why did you do that? And she said, when I looked at you, you didn't look strong. And I said, wow. And she goes, I loved you from the moment I saw you. It just touched my heart. And I also thought, I've often thought that in our weakness is when God is strongest. And he felt that. He sent an angel at the point when I was nervous and anxious. And that church has embraced us. And the first time I ever got up to speak in the pulpit was at West Parish. Mm-hmm. They welcomed me and Jim in, and we've eaten at more people's homes than ever. More than in our black church in New York. I'm just saying. And I thought to myself, and I looked to the Lord, thank you, Jesus. So now what I'm going to say, one of the songs that we sing and we hold hands, Ross, I Need You to Survive. What I like about this song, when I did it in West Parish, they said to me, wow, you know, we've sung songs about loving God, but not enough about loving each other. And this one is talking to your neighbor and saying, I need you to survive. So if you look at those words, please look at the words. And it's also another call and response. I just want to start off just giving you some of the words. I need you. You need me. Well, let's see a little. Listen.
You need me. We're all a part of God's body. Stand with me. Agree with me. We're all.
God's body, stand with me. Christ Unitarian Universalist, but Robin Miller, who should be ordained but isn't, we extend to our honorary ordination, just led us in a revival as I think has never been experienced here in Orleans.
Well,
thank you so much, Robin. And yes, the order of service has changed.